This is our second Paraklesis, which is a good thing, because we have this lesson, because the first of August was on Friday. We get more Paraklesis. Continue to pray for peace throughout the world. It's one of our initial prayers that we have in the church. It's very important. We talk about the destruction that took place in the areas of Iraq and the Gulf this, the perfect this, or whatever. We talk about what happened in bombings, you know, that took place over the course of however much time living in Syria. It's just the fact that over the course of the last week, there have been like 1,600 people. It's just sad. And so we need to pray. And we are coming together during a period of fasting, a period of reflection, and we need to pray. So please let us rise and pray for peace. Blessed are God always now and forever and to the ages of ages.
Oh,
For all is possible. Self has surrendered, for which reason, O Virgin? steadfast shelter and refuge, O Virgin. Disperse the woes of my many temptations, and force away the demonic attacks from me. Filled with the Holy why is this granted me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Behold, when the voice of your greeting came to my ears, the babe in my womb leaped for joy, and blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord and her spirit. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has regarded the low state of his handmaid. For behold, henceforth the generations will come to bless, for he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And Mary remained with her about 3 months, and returned to her home. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Christ is in our midst. It is difficult sometimes to say that those words with joy. Sometimes when Christ is in our midst, we find ourselves in the midst of suffering, in the midst of pain. In these times, they're so troubled. You know, there's always been wars fought. But I don't know why now it seems that, you know, there's more people dying because of these wars. People are not getting along. And not the kind of not getting along that's like, well, you need to return this, or you need to do this, or you need to, you know, talk a little more, or whatever. No, we're talking, you know, people going into areas that are not theirs and bombing things and shooting things, and it's just bad, it's ugly. And we say Christ is in our midst, not in jest. We don't say it as in our church as a you know, way of saying, you know, well, at least Christ is here. You know, because we pray the Holy Spirit, we pray, you know, that God is everywhere present and filling all things. We believe that. That's not something that we just pay lip service to. This is the crux of what the Holy Spirit is really about, and what God is really about in our lives, that He can be everywhere, that He can fill all things, that He can cleanse our souls, that He can remove every impurity. Or else what are we doing? We have to believe. We have to let this be our battle cry. When we say, save, O Lord, your people, and bless your inheritance whenever the cross comes around, as it is during these days, we have to believe that God has the power to heal, to bring peace. And not just in a quote-unquote superficial way into our souls, because sometimes we pay lip service to our soul as it's like this, you know, non-entity in our lives. That it's somehow, you know, something that doesn't exist because we can't see it. People going through psychological things and you know, where all they need is the church and they'd be healed. Where all they need would be Christ and they'd be healed. Not in every case, of course. Not oversimplifying. But the Holy Spirit has the ability to heal. It has the ability to comfort. It has the ability to bring Christ into the midst of even a battlefield, even a group of individuals that are you know, building a bomb to hurt others. We have to believe that. And we can say, why not? Well, we know why not, because at the same time, people's free will allows for them to make decisions that they're going to make. And it's not that God is powerless. If but one would open their heart and soul to the Lord in those moments through some love of a Christian somewhere. The power of Christ can show forth and heal multitudes of people. And we must understand that it is only in our own weakness that we nullify the ability of the Holy Spirit to be spread through our bodies. It's only in our weakness. It's only in our fear sometimes. It's only in our ability to say, nah, I'm working. Nah's not the time to do this. Nah, they don't want to. After all, isn't Christ everything? Isn't his death on the cross the final ransom for our lives? Haven't we been redeemed? And are in the process of allowing ourselves to ascend into the heights of heaven? It's hard for me to imagine that there's anything to be sorrowful about. And yet we have sorrow. We have struggles. Not just in the witnessing of just ugliness and hatred throughout the world, but even in our history, even in the saints of the church, every time we raise a martyr, we're also raising the hatred that killed them. I mean, today we celebrate St. Eusebius. That name doesn't mean anything to most of us. And until I read the Saint Eusebius, it doesn't mean anything to me, unfortunately. Until I read what this man stood for, that he, like the relics of St. Artemius that we keep within our temple, lived during a period of time where Christianity was illegal. And then, under the rule of Constantine the Great, it became legalized. But he was a soldier and served for 60 years in the ranks. The man did not die until he was 110 years of age. So what makes him a martyr? What makes him a martyr is because if you do the math, he served under Constantine the Great, and he was 110 years of age when he died. Who is the next person that he lived under? The great-grandnephew of Constantine the Great, otherwise known as Julian the Apostate. And he was an apostate because he wanted to be worshipped. He was a pagan. He didn't believe in this Christ stuff, this Jesus stuff. He was the emperor. He was the king. He was the God. He wanted the homage. He wanted the praise. He wanted the ego. And like St. Artemius, Eusebius, who served under Constantine the Great, and who served under Constantine's son, looked at Julian the Apostate and said, don't you remember what your great, what your granduncle, your great granduncle stood for? Don't you remember that he stood for Christ, that he died a Christian? A baptized Christian believing that Christ was the end all and be all, that he was the Alpha and the Omega? That there is no other God besides our Lord. Don't you remember this? How dare you try to bring back this demonic way of worshiping? You don't get to say those things to the emperor, really. And so he was beheaded at the age of 110 years old. And we raise Eusebius. Why do we raise Eusebius up? Excuse me. Because he had the nerve. He had the courage. He had the strength to stand in front of a person and say, no, Christ is more important. Life and everything. Christ is one. And that's what's lacking in so many aspects of our lives in general. Maybe not your lives, but just the collective of our lives. This is our struggle. How to ask the most important thing, and you're here, so you certainly need Jesus in the final idea, the most important thing for this year. And glory to God for that. But it's a struggle. It's a struggle, and our world is out to make us forget how important Jesus is in our lives. To the point where we're supposed to, you know, remove crosses from certain things and cater to other religions of other faiths. We don't have to. The Constitution says we're allowed to be Christians. And we've taken our freedom of religion to the point where we, the Constitution doesn't say we have to allow for other religions to exist inside our time, inside our heart, inside our soul. We stand for Christ. And to stand for Christ doesn't mean we pick up and go do battle as we see around the world, but it means that we, with patience and love, say, it's okay for you to believe. I don't believe what you believe, but you're not going to change my faith. Because I know that Christ is our Lord, and I know that He's our Lord and Master, and I believe. And I don't have to make room for you. Not in my life. I don't have to make room for your belief in my life. I don't. I'm allowed to be as convicted a Christian as possible. And you're allowed to believe what you want to believe. That's fine. But you don't have to push that on me. Or if you do, don't be offended if I don't believe. See, in this day and age, it's not that the Christians are becoming a minority. It's because it's that we are becoming afraid to speak. Because of some government opinion or some public opinion or some, you know, whatever. Well, the Christians have had their time, let everyone else. Just me. If Sigmund stood up, and not because he had 1,000 people backing him up, he stood up by himself at 110 years of age and said, no, I don't have to listen to you. Even though you are my enemy, I don't have to listen to you. And the or else is that you're just going to send me to my Lord and Savior sooner. So you don't get to win, Julian the Apostate. You don't get to claim me. You can claim my head, if that's all you get. That message of being the loving and trying to be loving towards this Julian, to try to explain to him the truth, but to stand up for Christ, we need that. We need that. There is only one. He had only one love. And this time, these 14 days preceding Kinesis, this time is the time to honor those that said yes to the most sacrificial obedience that mankind has ever known. One that almost was stoned, and one to the point of death, even the death on the cross. It's our time to be sacrificial. And He has placed in our hands the ability to witness His name. He wants us to. He asks us to. He gives greater joy and love to those that do this. And peace. We should strive for this. And take the example of our Lord on that he had sin of sickness, who's remembered what we remember today, and allow that strength to be their strength. So that in a world that desperately needs to hear his name said with authority and power, we may have the power and authority to speak. To the glory of his name. Please let us rise and we will continue. Glory to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father, Word, and Spirit, the Trinity in oneness. Wash away my many personal offenses, now and forever, and unto the ages of ages. Amen. Through the intercessions of the Theotokos, merciful One, wash away my many personal offenses. Have mercy upon you, God, according to your great mercy, according to the multitude of your compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Put me not into the hands of any human protection. Lord, hear me most holy, but do not receive the prayers of your supplicant. Sorrow has taken me, and I am unable to withstand under the demon's darts. Shelter I do not have, nor a place to go, worthless that I am. Battle from all sides am I, and no consolation have I with thee. Lady of humanity, the shelter of the faithful and their hope, do not reject my prayers to you, to the things that God one is turned away from you, ashamed and empty, who flee unto you, O King of the host. But one asks for the favor, and the gift is received from you, to the advantage of their own. Thank you. bestow her of mercy, that you pour from God, which we are not begot, from sin, deliver us from the soul's defilement. We cry out this victory.
In my body, in my soul.
up the first fashion man, and he has saved our souls from Have mercy on us, O God. According to your great mercy, we pray to you. Hear us and have mercy. Father, Silas, and all the clergy and the laity in Christ.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for mercy, life, peace, health, salvation, visitation, forgiveness, and remission of the sins of the servants of God, all pious and Orthodox Christians, those living and visiting in this community and city, the members, council, members, contributors, your relatives, members, and benefactors of this holy church.
Lord,
pray for the servants of God whose names have been commemorated throughout this Paraklesis service, for those in the suffering in war, for those in their families that are suffering in sickness, for those that we prayerfully call to mind at this time, and for all those here present and their families who await your grand and abundant mercy. Again, we pray for the safekeeping of this holy church and of this city and of all cities and towns from pestilence, famine, earthquake, flood, fire, and sword, from invasion of enemies, civil war, and unforeseen death. Wish with mercy that he will be kind to and treat us our good God who loves all people, that he may turn away and scatter all wrath and disease that moves against us, and deliver us from his impending justified chastisement, and have mercy upon us.
Therefore, we fall down to you, Father.
before you, most holy one, Mother of our God, guard me with care within your shelter. Bless you, and we will see you, God willing, tomorrow evening.